So chapter one, you know how usually when you take a class and the instructor bothers to teach from chapter one or chapter two, you're like, meh, this is going to be a breeze. You know, whatever's in chapter one is usually review or very self-explanatory. Well, not so much with A&P. Our first informational slide, which is really slide two, is about as easy as this is going to get. And then from here on out, we're just going to pile it on. It will feel, by the time you take the first exam, as if there is more information. The volume is so massive that you can't handle it. You can't manage. You will feel overwhelmed. And then exam two material will feel like it's even more. And exam three material will feel like it's even more. So we're just going to ramp it up. Ramp it up. Crazy class. So on this second slide, just a quick explanation of what anatomy versus physiology are, okay? Anatomy are the parts. And most people find it fairly easy to study anatomy because it's more or less sheer memorization, okay? But if you have a lot to memorize, then it becomes crazy. And so, of course, yes, we have lots to memorize, okay? Physiology is the how of the body. How do these parts work? How does the body get things done? So we could be talking about for instance, how two bones might interact, but often what we're going to focus on is, oh wow, that font is so tiny. That's ridiculous. I think the last time I used this app, I was writing teeny tiny. Often people struggle with the cellular level of physiology, and just, you know, fair warning, we will go that far. We will get into that much detail, even this quarter. 242 tends to focus even more so on physiology than 241. And therefore, if you find that you struggle with physiology, you might come back and report that 242 seems more difficult to you. That being said, we're going to move to a list. And this list actually requires two slides, simply because the slides would get too crowded if I had left all the information in one place. But this is a list of the things that living organisms need to be able to do. Necessary life functions, slide three, the things that living organisms need to be able to do, okay? The abilities that they need to be able to have, okay? For instance, a living organism must be able to maintain boundaries, whether it's a unicellular organism or a multicellular organism. If we're talking about a unicellular organism, then the most probably conspicuous boundary is plasma membrane, right? But if we're talking about a unicellular eukaryote, then some other boundaries that are relevant would be the boundaries that establish organelles, which are essentially plasma membrane, same components, phospholipid bilayer, right? Where we're, you know, studying humans or really any really large multicellular organism, wow, there are actually a lot of boundaries to consider. So skin, for instance, is a really significant boundary. Technically, it offers lots of boundaries, but we'll come back to that soon enough. We have sheets of tissue that are called mucosae line, any part of the body that's open to the outside. So I have mucosae lining my nasal cavity. I have mucosae lining my oral cavity. I have mucosae lining my esophagus. I have mucosae lining my stomach. I have mucosae lining my small intestine, so on and so forth. And those provide boundaries. We also have sheets of tissue that are collectively called serosae. Serosae will be especially important in body cavities, but we'll come back to that later in this chapter. They are sheets of tissue that are not exposed to the outside, okay? At least that's the most straightforward definition we can give right now, okay, without understanding more about body cavities. So the point is that cells, individual cells in our bodies, they have boundaries that need to be maintained. Neurons are an especially relevant example. They have to maintain boundaries in order to control where ions sit, whether they're sitting more so on the outside of the cell or more so on the inside of the cell. Skin is a great example of a boundary. Mucosae are boundaries. Serosae are boundaries. Maintaining boundaries helps certainly to protect, but also to establish gradients. Very important for gradients. Living organisms need to be able to achieve movement, which is not necessarily locomotion. Yes, locomotion is a movement, but it's not the only sort of flavor of movement. Locomotion would be, translocating, moving from one point to another, but not all organisms locomote, right? That doesn't mean that an organism that doesn't locomote, like a tree, doesn't also need to be able to move. So for instance, a tree has to move sugars and other nutrients, as well as water, through its body in order to serve both distal or distant leaves and distal or distant roots. So moving things through a body and also possibly moving a body about, okay? We have three types of tissues that help us to move things through our body, but also help us to locomote: skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle, and smooth muscle, but we'll come back to those soon enough. A living organism needs to be able to detect. That's what we mean here by sense. Stimuli, or changes in stimuli, and to respond, be able to respond to those stimuli. And in a nutshell, that's called responsiveness. Living organisms must be able to respond to stimuli. If they can't detect changes in stimuli, then there's no hope of responding. Digestion, I don't know why that ampersand is there. Typo. Actually, I don't need to type breakdown or write breakdown. That's silly. But we can get rid of the ampersand. Digestion is technically the breaking down of macromolecules in order to yield nutrient monomers. Nutrient monomers. Yes, we have proteins aplenty in our blood, but those proteins are proteins that we make. They are not proteins that we ingest. The proteins that we ingest, we digest, break down, to yield nutrient monomers. Who are the nutrient monomers for protein molecules? That's right, amino acids. Amino acids. We then absorb those amino acids across the wall, primarily of the small intestine, and into the bloodstream. So another aspect of, for instance, the digestive system is absorption. Absorption. Just because I ingested it, just because I digested it, doesn't mean that all of my cells are getting served. If I don't successfully absorb, then it doesn't matter that I ingested. It doesn't matter that I digested. Okay. Back to nutrient monomers for just a hot second. How about carbohydrates? When we digest carbohydrates, What are the nutrient monomers that are yielded? Most people can list at least one. There are three carbohydrate monomers. We talked about amino acids. And the three carbohydrate monomers are glucose. Hopefully that's the one that you did get. Fructose. And galactose. So for instance, if you listed maybe lactose. No, that's actually not a carbohydrate monomer. That's still a polymer. Okay, there are only three carbohydrate monomers. Anywho, we're going to go to the next slide, which is slide number four. But it's really just a continuation of the same list. Okay? Living organisms need to be able to perform many metabolic reactions, which are collectively called metabolism. Okay? Some of these reactions are catabolic. Some of these reactions are anabolic. And I remember the difference between catabolism and anabolism, actually thanks to a colleague that I once had. She taught me that if I have a room full of cats with maybe some breakable things about, they are eventually going to break some of those things. They're going to break that vase. They're going to break that dish, right? It's going to be too chaotic. And so I can remember, because of cats, too many cats in a room, that catabolism is breakdown. Okay, and then by default, I can infer that anabolism is the buildup or the synthesis, the production of molecules. Okay, but all of that is called metabolism. Living organisms also need to be able to perform excretion, which it essentially means get rid of. So anything an organism can't digest, anything that would be toxic or would alter the pH of an organism, the organism needs to rid its body of those things. In our case, certainly the things we can't digest, we eliminate as feces, excess ions, excess fluid, we eliminate in urine, the byproduct of protein digestion, or one of the byproducts of protein digestion, ammonia, we convert it into urea and then we eliminate it in urine, okay? We eliminate some excess ions and some excess water via sweat. We eliminate CO2, which if we allowed it to stay in our blood would greatly alter our pH via our lungs, via our respiratory system, right? So eliminate. And then reproduction and growth is having these two terms is actually a little bit redundant, okay? Sure, when we think of reproduction, we think of brown chick or brown cow, right? We think about making more babies, making more copies of self, right? Or at least a close copy, babies, right? But we actually perform reproduction in order to grow, replace, repair, okay? So that's why I say it's a little redundant. I think most people don't think of growth as a type of reproduction, and that's why it's maybe necessary to include that. So I want you to notice that we just made a list, necessary life functions, and on this list we have seven abilities, if you will: maintaining boundaries, movement of the body, but also through the body, responsiveness, digestive functions, metabolic functions, excretion, and then reproduction slash growth. Okay? A list of seven. All right? The reason why I'm making a big fuss about how many things are on this list, the reason why I'm making a big fuss about what necessary life functions means is because very soon, later in this lecture, in this chapter, we're going to have yet another list that feels very, very similar. And it's going to be difficult for you to keep them straight. So I'm trying to help you out with that by maybe pointing out how many things are on the list. Now, you'll notice that the next slide is blank. It's blank, actually, for me, in case I need to, quote unquote, write on the board. So often I'll insert a blank slide into my lectures in case I need to maybe make a table with you, right? Or I need to sketch something with you. Okay. And we might need that. We just don't need it right this second. So I'm going to move on to the next slide, which is slide 6. Humans, of course, are multicellular. Okay. And that's wonderful, but it's also a pain in the hiney because it means that some of our cells are more exposed than others. Some of our cells are more exposed to O2. Directly than others. Some of our cells are more exposed to nutrients more directly than others. So in order to function as a multicellular organism, we need our cells, we need our tissues, we need, in our case, our organs, and even our organ systems to work together. They have to work together. Okay? And that brings us to, well, actually, where did I put that list? That will bring us to the idea of survival needs, but boy, I'm having a hard time finding where I put those. Let me double check. Well, I figured out why I couldn't find that list. I somehow deleted it. Okay, this is a list of the conditions and supplies, if you will, that organisms need to survive. So these are not abilities that organisms need to have. These are more like the things that organisms need to be able to access, okay? Actually, I want to start somewhere else. Organisms need to be able to access nutrients. Organisms need to be able to access water. Water acts as a solvent. It allows, for instance, those nutrient monomers to be dissolved. It's a reactant, so it's important for metabolism. It's a transport medium. It's a thermoregulator. It's amazing, both in our bodies and on our planet. Excuse me. Organisms need access to oxygen, especially aerobic organisms that are using oxygen as a final electron acceptor to perform aerobic respiration, and that very much describes us, okay? And also appropriate amounts, matchy-matchy amounts of these sort of supplies. Not too much, not too little. Appropriate pressure surrounding them. Again, not too much, not too little. In our case, this is really what allows us to perform ventilation. So it allows us to take air into the body and send air out of the body. In other words, breathe. Okay. And another condition that must be met, an appropriate or normal body temperature. What's the issue with body temp that is too low? Yeah, if it's too low, then our metabolic reactions can't proceed fast enough. That's potentially life-threatening. What if normal body temperature, or body temperature, I should say, is outside that norm? It's too high. It's too high. What's the issue? Yeah. We're putting ourselves at risk of denaturing our proteins and our DNA. I'm going to go ahead and say no bueno. Okay, now notice how many things on this list. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Whereas the list we had earlier, 7. Right? Survival needs versus necessary life functions. Okay? And again, I would maybe call these conditions or supplies or both. Okay. Now, just a moment ago, I mentioned that our organ systems need to be able to work together. Okay, so we're actually gonna preview quite a bit before we move on in the lecture, and that's why the next slide is blank, just to give me plenty of space to talk about some new stuff, or maybe review old stuff, depends on what your experiences are or have been. Okay, so let's see. Let's start with, Let's start with vitamin D synthesis. In other words, the production of vitamin D, okay? Now, you may have heard or concluded that we absorb vitamin D through our skin, or that we somehow make sunlight into vitamin D. That is incorrect. Stop telling lies. Vitamin D is synthesized in a really rather involved series of reactions. And yes, that cascade does start in the skin. In our skin, we have a particular cholesterol molecule, and specifically it's housed in our epidermis, okay? And I'm going to call this cholesterol molecule, I'm going to give it a nickname, precursor A, okay? Precursor A in the epidermis, once it's exposed to sunlight, it changes shape, and it gets converted into what I'm going to call, again, this is just a nickname, precursor B, okay? And precursor B enters the bloodstream. All right? And it's on its way to specifically the liver. Okay, the liver converts precursor B into what I'm going to nickname. Do each of these molecules have more official and actually more nasty names? Yes, of course, of course. Let it go. Okay, again, the liver converts precursor B into what we're calling precursor C. Okay, precursor C then enters the blood, Okay. This time, we're headed to the kidneys. Okay. And the kidneys convert precursor C into... Why did I use A, B, C? Oh, vitamin D. A, B, C, D. Okay. So, in other words, the kidneys can't themselves convert precursor A directly into vitamin D. We need the entire cascade. Okay? Nor do we absorb vitamin D through our skin. Well, this is an example of our skin, our circulatory system, arguably our digestive system. The liver is often lumped in with the digestive system, and our excretory system or our urinary system, the kidneys, all working together to achieve one mutual and mutually beneficial end. Okay? Another example that I want to preview sooner than later in the quarter requires us to draw a snake. I erased my snake. That was dumb. No bueno. So personally, I see maybe like a python dripping off of maybe a tree branch. I'll explain that little bit that I just drew in a hot second. Okay, so here's our snake, and maybe you, like me, you see the head of the snake, okay, making this area here, mouth of the snake, okay? And I just put a ball of yarn into this snake's mouth. Here's a piece of yarn leading to the ball, and here's a piece of yarn leading away from the ball, okay? If that's the snake's head, and the rest of this business is snake body. Okay. Do we have snakes inside of our bodies? Hopefully not. Okay. So what the heck am I drawing? I'm actually drawing parts of your kidneys. What color should we use? Maybe that. Okay. Where this unit here, the snake's head and the ball of yarn. This is called the renal corpuscle. And even though you won't study the details, the torturous details of the urinary system until pretty late in 242, knowing what a nephron looks like. The nephron is the snake. Sooner than later will definitely help, okay? And then the rest of this, the snake body, if you will, it's called the renal tubule. Okay. That ball of yarn, of course, is not a ball of yarn. Like, I can think of as pretty nasty intestinal blockage if you've got a ball of yarn in front of you or inside of you. So this ball here that I just circled in that lighter green, that's actually a capillary bed. It's a capillary bed that's called a glomerulus. Or some people say glomerulus. I don't care. It's not an oral exam, but also different people in different parts of the world have different pronunciations. So as long as you can spell it, I think we're in good shape. If you have to mispronounce something, in fact, in order to spell it correctly, do it. That is worth it. That is worth it. Okay. But again, this entire structure that I've drawn in black, the snake, in other words. Oops. That whole thing is called a nephron, okay? Each kidney has about 1 million nephrons packed into it. So this is something very, very tiny, okay? And each nephron has associated with it one glomerulus, that ball of yarn. All sorts of things leave the blood at the site of the glomerulus and therefore enter the nephron. Okay? Excess water, excess ions, and arguably, most important, nitrogenous waste. Okay? Nitrogenous waste are the byproducts of protein digestion. When we break down proteins, we yield ammonia. And we all do that, and we all normally do that. That's just part of a healthy body, okay? But ammonia is toxic stuff. I mean, if you just think about the reaction that you have walking through a stairwell that maybe has been urinated in many times, you're probably thinking of the same stairwell that I am in downtown Seattle. You know, that kind of, that repulses you, that smell of sort of urine on top of urine on top of urine. It's repulsive, and you are hardwired to find that to be noxious so that you avoid it. You know, your body's telling you that's something nasty, okay? Ammonia is, yeah, toxic. It's bad news for you, and it's not something that you want to hold on to, okay? So, if ammonia is a byproduct of protein digestion, then where do we form this ammonia, at least primarily? Well, where are proteins digested primarily? Yeah, they're digested in the stomach, okay? So ammonia that's formed in the stomach is going to be absorbed into the bloodstream. Well, where do we perform the majority of absorption of nutrient monomers? Yeah, in the small intestine, okay? So we're gonna send that ammonia into the small intestine, along with, of course, the amino acids, sort of the goal of protein digestion. And we're going to absorb that ammonia into the bloodstream across the wall of the small intestine, all right? Now, that ammonia is going to be carried by the blood, not too far, to the liver. Hopefully you're already starting to appreciate that the liver is sort of like the everything organ. What doesn't happen there? It's so busy. Okay. The liver then converts. I think a neighbor's using like a power tool or something. Maybe it's like a weed whack. Can you guys hear that? Kind of driving me nuts. The liver then converts that ammonia, primarily most of it, into urea. Urea, okay? Urea is another type of nitrogenous waste. Ammonia is a nitrogenous waste. Urea is a nitrogenous waste. Okay? Well, why bother spending ATP in order to form urea? Why bother? Well, urea, it's not fantastic. It's somewhat toxic. It's not like I want to drink a bunch of it. But urea is less toxic than ammonia. Therefore, being a terrestrial organism, I can store urea in my body. Being a terrestrial organism with ammonia as my primary nitrogenous waste, that just would not make sense. I can't afford to store a toxin in my body. Toxins are unstable molecules that will perform chemical reactions that are undesired or undesirable, okay? So I want to be able to choose when to eliminate my nitrogenous waste because I'm terrestrial. Therefore, I bother to convert at least most of it into urea, okay? Well, urea then gets picked up by, yet again, the blood mobile. Thank you, they might be giants. And the blood takes that urea to the kidneys, okay? What are the units or the portions of the kidneys? What parts of the kidneys are going to claim that urea? Yeah, it's going to leave the glomeruli, which is plural for glomerulus, and enter the nephrons. Well, that process of removing things from the blood, really anywhere, doesn't have to just be the kidneys. It's called filtration, and that's the job of the renal corpuscle, filtration, okay? And then this really long, really extensive snake body, the renal tubule, its job is to play back and forth, give a little, take a little, give a little, take a little, give a little, take a little, with the content of the fluid, which is called filtrate, that's moving through, okay? That fluid is called filtrate. And the renal tubule is reclaiming some materials, things that we don't actually want to eliminate, okay, and secreting others, things that maybe were too stubborn to be filtered out of the blood but still need to be forced into the urine, okay? So this fluid is traveling through. When it's traveling through a neuron, it's called filtrate. And
I just said neuron, but I mean nephron, of course.
Neuron will share with many other neurons, but not all other neurons.
Nephrons.
What's called a collecting duct. This thing is called a collecting duct. What do you think the fluid at the base of the collecting duct is called? Yeah, by the time the collecting duct has collected and adjusted, right, that filtrate just so, the end product is going to be urine. Okay? This is another, obviously very involved, example of different organ systems working together. We needed the digestive system. Right? We need the circulatory system. We needed the urinary system to all work together in order to successfully rid the body of nitrogenous waste. Cool beans? Okay. Keep that kind of handy, the nephron diagram, because it will come in handy later, and not that much later. Okay. I might need more of that blank slide later, but for now, let's move to the next slide, which is number 8. Depending on who you ask, depending on who the authors are of whatever book you're referring to, we have 10, maybe 11, some people might argue 12 organ systems, and they all cooperate with each other. They all need each other in order to perform their functions successfully. Here's the rule of thumb at the 241 level. Until I formally introduce an organ system, like until we get to that organ system's chapter, okay? For now, in other words, in chapter 1, you need to know the main organs, the chief organs for each organ system, and you need to be able to list at least 2 functions performed by that organ system. The first organ system we'll talk about is the integumentary system, both here in this lecture, but also it's the first that we'll come to in the quarter. It's chapter 5, so, and that's actually fair game for exam 1, so it's coming very soon. Obviously, the main organ is going to be skin. Integument and skin are one and the same thing, okay? And skin obviously acts as a huge boundary, a huge barrier, and therefore provides protection to some degree. Not just from some injuries, like injury to deeper organs, but also protection against desiccation. And desiccation means drying out. Why am I using my actual handwriting that no one can read? That's dumb. Have fun! Okay, so to desiccate means to dry out. Dehydration and desiccation are not the same thing. You have been dehydrated at some point in your life, and you are fine. If you were to desiccate, you would be crunchy. So, definitely don't want to desiccate, but desiccation is a huge threat, a huge challenge that terrestrial living presents. So one of our coping mechanisms for the challenge of desiccation is skin, okay? our skin also helps to protect us from being infiltrated, invaded by foreigners like pathogens or would-be pathogens, okay? So if you were taking a TESA exam and I asked you to list a function of the skin, just a function, yeah, you could say protect. Let's say you were taking an exam and I asked you to list 7 functions of the skin and you listed protects and you didn't tell me what it protects us from, then that's a bit vague. So again, protects against injury, protects against desiccation, protects against, you could say infection if that's an easier word for you to remember. And then we also already established earlier in this lecture that skin, the epidermis, really contributes to this vitamin D synthesis cascade. It sort of starts that ball rolling. And the skin houses many of our receptors, our sensory receptors. Now, the word receptor is actually kind of a pain in the hiney. So in just a moment, I'm going to go off on a huge tangent there. Our skin also houses sweat glands. We actually have a variety of sweat glands, as well as sebaceous glands. Okay. Sebaceous glands make sebum, which is an oil-like substance. Okay. Now that we've replaced the term oil with sebaceous, I feel that it's fair game for me to hold you responsible for the term sebaceous. Okay. Also notice that on these slides, these organ system slides, I've given you a little note. Hey, the integumentary system is a focus, for instance, of 241. The next slide, skeletal system, is a focus of 241. The next slide, muscular system, 241, so on and so forth. And then you'll notice that I'll suddenly start writing 242, just so you know sort of which beasts to expect when. Okay, now let's go off on that receptor tangent. And in order to do that, I need some space. So unfortunately, I'm going to have to go to slide 4, or I think it's actually slide 5, the blank slide that we didn't use earlier. Let's get rid of that table. Okay. Now, I want you to be aware that the term receptor is the devil. Really, it's not receptor's fault. It's English's fault. English is the devil. We have too many words to describe the same thing, and yet often we have a word that means more than one thing, and receptor is one of those. So be aware that the surface of our cells, the surface of really any cell, it doesn't have to be a human cell, okay? Its plasma membrane, in other words, bears lots and lots of proteins. Far more than I could represent in this very two-dimensional drawing. So I'm underrepresenting how many receptors one of our cells might feature, okay? In addition to receptors, our cells have proteins that don't necessarily bind to anything else, but they might be identifiers, okay? So plasma membrane is just loaded with all sorts of proteins. We'll come back to that both in this quarter and in 242. Some of these are functionally receptors. They're proteins, but they're specifically proteins that act as receptors. And a receptor in this context binds to some sort of signaling molecule. So maybe this is a signaling molecule bound to that receptor, okay? Or maybe this is a signaling molecule bound to that receptor, all right? and that chemical signal might turn off or turn on a function of the cell. In other words, sort of direct or boss around the cell. Hey cell, you need to divide. Or hey cell, you need to make more of your proteins. Or hey cell, stop making so many proteins. Or hey cell, you know those enzymes you have inside of you? Let's activate some of them. You know, just all sorts of different cell functions can be controlled via chemical signals, okay? So the term receptor has this cellular meaning, okay? Which will be relevant in 241. But it also has multicellular, excuse me, meaning, if we say sensory receptor, okay, we're talking about a cell or a collection of cells that detect a change in a stimulus. So you have oodles and oodles and oodles of photoreceptors on the back and sides of your inner eyeball. Those are sensory receptors. You have oodles and oodles and oodles of receptors, sensor receptors, that detect a change in the position of your head, and those are located in your ear. You have oodles and oodles and oodles of receptors that are sensitive to changes in odorants. They detect the presence of smell molecules, essentially, okay? But you also have oodles and oodles and oodles of sort of like touch receptors, okay? So the first thing we want to do where sensory receptors are concerned is we want to delineate between general sensory receptors, okay, and what are unfortunately called special. It's a little misleading. Special sensory receptors, okay? In the human body, photoreceptors would be an example of a special, or examples of special sensory receptors. Whereas touch receptors, because we have so many different touch receptors and such a huge volume of touch receptors, those would be considered general. Also, general sensory receptors, they tend to be found throughout the body. Special sensory receptors are located in your head, somewhere in your head, whether they're buried in your ear, buried in your eye, buried in your nasal cavity, located in your oral cavity. They're all located in your head, okay? So, and by the way, the special word for head is cephalic. These are cephalic in location, and these are just about everywhere, hence they are general. Okay, and our go-to example of a general sensory receptor is one of the many, many different kinds of touch receptors that we have, whereas photoreceptors would be an example of a special sensory receptor. How do you spell receptor? Good grief. So just to clarify, this is something, this kind of matchy-matchy protein that's worn on a cell. Or actually, there is, certainly the case where a receptor is inside the cell, but it's sort of a part of a cell, okay? Whereas sensory receptors, each sensory receptor is either a cell or a collection of cells, okay? And they're typically neurons, which you might think of as the functional cells of the nervous system, or cells that are neuron-like. Okay. We have, in actuality, far more general sensoroceptors than we do special sensoroceptors. We have lots of both, but we have far more of the general sensoroceptors, and that kind of makes sense if you stop to think about how many different kinds there are and how widespread they are. But don't worry, we will come back automatically to the idea of sensoreceptors. Right now, I just want you to get the basic concept down and not worry about what kind of touch receptors there are and what kind of special sensoroceptors there are. That'll come up, and it'll come up soon enough, okay? For now, I just want you to get the idea that sensory receptors are responsible for detection. They detect changes in stimuli, okay? And they relay, or I shouldn't say they, that information that our stimulus has changed is relayed to a command center or an integration center.
Your job's so crazy right now. Mm-hmm.
Did you know that you're
not learning?
You're now on this lecture, by the way. All right. And the pathway that information is taking, okay, sometimes it's called the sensory pathway because the type of information that's being carried is sensory, it's input, okay? But it's also called the afferent pathway. Afferent. Okay? The command center or integration center is the portion of the nervous system that actually interprets. So the job here was detection, whereas the job here is interpretation. Okay, and devising a plan, what to do about this change in the stimulus. All right, that plan, whatever that plan is, oh, I'm running out of space. That's all right, I'll get squeezy with it. It's very similar to Jiggy, but not at all. That plan is more information, but it's not input, it's output. And so often the pathway that we're taking to effectors, the parts of the body that actually elicit, carry out the plan, sometimes it's called motor, or the information that it's carrying is sometimes called a motor plan, which makes sense. Oh, I don't like the way that motor looks there. Ish. Okay. Or the efferent pathway, and I'll always over enunciate that first E. Now, obviously, the terms. Uh-oh, I just pressed a funny button. Not my first time either. There, hopefully that's resolved. Gosh, I really don't like the way this looks. I think I'll redo it so it all fits, but not on your time. So when we come back, it'll look clean. Okay, I like that better. And I think in this app, you probably never get to see the original anyway, so I should just lie and tell you. Yeah, this clean version is what I had from the beginning. Oh, anywho, effectors, they elicit that planned response, okay? That information about what the plan is, it's carried along an efferent pathway. And again, I'm always going to over-enunciate that E just to make sure that we can remember motor efferent, sensory afferent, okay? Now, personally, I use this trick. EFF goes to EFF. And that way I can keep my afferent and efferent straight, even though they're such similar terms. Okay? In our bodies, let's see, what color should I use here? Maybe the same as this. That command or integration center, it's typically our central nervous system. Not always our brain, but often our brain, central nervous system. Okay? And the effectors, we actually have four flavors, if you will, of effectors in our bodies. Maybe I should give you some bullets. Glands, for instance, sweat glands, endocrine glands, for instance. Skeletal muscle is called skeletal muscle because most skeletal muscle is attached to our skeleton. Cardiac muscle associated with the heart. And smooth muscle. Okay, these are the effectors that elicit that planned response. Okay? The sooner you can get this pathway down, the better. All right? And I think maybe I also had a little note about these guys being, a neuron or a group of neurons, I should say, or neuron-like cells. The sensory receptors. So entire cells, not parts of cells, right? Whereas cellular receptors are part of a cell. Evil, evil English language. So rude. Now, it's not going to hurt us to be more informative. Maybe you know that we have a peripheral nervous system. Well, it's these afferent and efferent pathways that comprise essentially the peripheral nervous system, which is nice. Nice to know that sooner than later. Okay, let's move along. And we had actually backed up so that I could get to that blank slide. Our next slide, officially, is slide 10, the skeletal system. Another system that we'll focus on in 241, okay? Yes, our skeletal system includes bones, but it doesn't only include bones. We also rely on a variety of cartilages, different types of cartilages, to help fulfill the functions that our skeletal system provides. And we'll find out that there are other important contributors for our skeletal system. But functionally, our skeletal system helps to certainly support organs as well as protect, but I think we just established that that term protect is pretty vague. So if we think of some of the vital organs, the brain, the heart, the skeletal system provides encasement for those organs, okay? The lungs, the ribs help to encase the lungs, for instance, okay? Our skeletal system also provides leverage specifically for skeletal muscles. If you like anchorage better, I understand that. That's okay. Our skeletal system, especially our bones, helps to store minerals calcium phosphate salts, and performs hematopoiesis. Hematopoiesis is the production of blood cells. And even though it's a fancy term, it's a general term. It means the production of any blood cells. Whereas the production of red blood cells, like we were specifically talking just about red blood cells, that type of hematopoiesis has an even fancier name. It's called erythropoiesis. If we were talking specifically about white blood cells, that type of hematopoiesis has an even fancier name, leukopoiesis, okay? So hematopoiesis just means production of any and all blood cells. And that's the job specifically of bone marrow, red bone marrow, okay? We'll obviously come back to the skeletal system since it's one of the focuses of 241. That will mostly be applicable in exam 2. And I guess you could say the anatomy of the skeletal system is going to come back to haunt us in both practica and the final. Next slide, which is 11. The muscular system is another focus of 241. And again, the tissue components of the muscular system are skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle, smooth muscle. Skeletal muscles in particular help us to express ourselves, help us to locomote, help us to manipulate objects, okay? But smooth muscle more so helps us to move fluids through our body. Whether we're talking about the fluid that is air, or we're talking about the fluid that is chyme in the stomach, or we're talking about the fluid that is a stool, okay? Skeletal muscles especially help us to maintain posture, and all of our muscle cells, excuse me, they are big spenders. They spend a lot of ATP, and therefore they generate a lot of heat. And actually, when you're cold enough to shiver, what's happening is your skeletal muscles are contracting rapidly without your sort of permission, without your will. You don't have to will them to do that. And that's what's causing you to shiver. What are they really doing? They're generating heat. So cool. Next slide, the nervous system. The nervous system is not just a focus of 241. It is a massive, massive focus of 241. And it comes back to haunt us in 242 again and again and again and again. So just to kind of come to grips with how bulky the nervous system is, we have 5 chapters dedicated to the nervous system this quarter. And all in all, we're going to go over 10 chapters. So roughly half of the volume that we're going to struggle with this quarter will be nervous system. So wow, that's a lot. So no wonder I've already started previewing some of the nitty-gritty of the nervous system. The nervous system acts as that interpreter, that integrator, that command center. It also acts as a sort of a relay mechanism, relaying sensory, relaying motor, right? And is therefore linked to both sensory receptors, which are actually typically neurons, so that's also nervous system, right? And effectors. Who are the 4 effectors in the human body? That's right. Glands, skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle, smooth muscle, all right? And at least our central nervous system, our brain, provides us with what we call memory. All right, next slide, which is 13, the endocrine system. The endocrine system is, it actually comes up many, many times in many, many chapters, but it's focused on in chapter 16, and therefore a lot of instructors will start 242 with the endocrine system. Not everyone does, but a lot of us do. And the endocrine system is a tough one because by definition, a hormone is a cellular signal or a cell signal that travels via the bloodstream. Cell signal via the bloodstream. Wow, well, that's a lot of different chemicals. There are so many different types of hormones, and different hormones have different targets. Different hormones elicit different responses in different targets. So having to learn all of those different hormones, all of their targets, all of their possible responses, or all of the possible responses that they elicit, that's a lot of work for one chapter. It's kind of a beast, okay? Now, both our endocrine system and our nervous system function in coordination. Why is coordination necessary? Because we're multicellular. We want to regulate the activities of our cells. If all of our cells were maximally active simultaneously, well, that's not sustainable. That's just not sustainable. So these two systems help us to regulate which cells are doing what and when. That seems like overkill. Why have two systems that are both responsible for coordination or integration, if you prefer? Well, they each come with their own deficits and their own benefits. And so by having both, we kind of enjoy the best of both worlds. The nervous system allows us to elicit responses quickly, whereas the endocrine system elicits responses more slowly. The endocrine system elicits longer lasting responses, while the nervous system elicits more short-lived responses. So if we have both, then we get those quick responses and we get those long-lasting responses, all right? The endocrine system regulates a variety of bodily functions, including but not limited to reproduction slash growth, metabolism, certainly, okay? Including nutrient usage. Let's move to our next slide. The circulatory system, pretty beastly. It takes up three chapters of our book. It's a focus of 242, okay? And includes the heart, the vessels, and the blood, which are all pretty meaty topics, okay? In this class, in 241, you should be able to generate a fairly large list of blood cargo, things that the blood carries, right? We wanna know why it's necessary to have blood, what kinds of deliveries is the blood making. There's a list already shown here, okay? So we can steal that, certainly. Actually, let me do this. Right, oxygen is some of the cargo that blood carries. CO2 is some of the cargo that blood carries. Hormones, by definition, are carried via the blood. Clotting factors, which are proteins, what isn't, just about everything has a protein, that function in minimizing internal blood loss. Okay. Chemical precursors, for instance, precursor C that we talked about in the vitamin D synthesis pathway, okay? Urea, we already talked about as well, and ammonia for that matter, antibodies, which are also proteins. Hormones are proteins as well, by the way. Carrier proteins. There are some things that we need to carry in the blood, but they're a little too reactive, or they're a little too eager to leave the bloodstream. And so in order to sort of hold them in place or keep them steady or stabilizing them, we attach them to a carrier protein. Bicarbonate is a very important piece of cargo in the blood. It's actually the form that CO2 is carried in primarily. A variety of blood cells are delivered, carried, are allowed to circulate via blood. A variety of enzymes are carried in the blood. Heat is carried in the blood. That one's less tangible, and so people tend to forget about that one. And then nutrients. And then notice that I put an asterisk here next to nutrients. That's because already in this lecture, you can do better than that. Who are the nutrient monomers of proteins? Amino acids. Who are the nutrient monomers of carbohydrates? Glucose? Galactose, fructose. Okay, who are the nutrient monomers of lipids? Primarily fatty acid chains and glycerol. All right. So you can get a much longer list by really teasing out those nutrient monomers. Okay. What's the chief function of the heart? Momentum. To give that blood momentum, send it as far as possible. Okay. Let's go to the next slide. The lymphatic and immune systems. Sometimes authors will treat these as one, which is, I think, a little misleading. Like they'll say lymphatic / immune, okay? But we will treat them as separately in 242. They'll have their own chapters each, okay? The lymphatic system is sometimes the most ignored system. It's probably the system that you are aware of the least, okay? It is a series of connected vessels, tubes, all right. However, they're blind-ended, so the fluid within them, which is called lymph, doesn't get circulated. It's constantly made new or unnew or fresh, okay? And what the lymphatic system is doing is it's picking up excess fluid that sort of leaks, more or less, out of the circulatory system and redistributing it, and while it's transporting this fluid, it's also cleaning it, it's filtering it. So in that sense, the lymphatic system is a major, very, very important filtration system, okay? And the lymphatic system also provides housing for white blood cells, and that opportunity of being housed provides white blood cells surveillance sites, like a place to watch for bad guys. Maturation sites, a place to kind of further develop, okay? Proliferation sites, space to make copies, okay? Differentiation sites, space to make specific and sort of polished copies, okay? All of that housing provides white blood cells with lots and lots of sort of opportunities, okay? Our immune system allows us to not just fight, potentially pathogenic foreigners, not just identify potentially pathogenic foreigners, but also prevent them from entering the body in the first place, or preventing them from getting very far in the body. Now, some of the harmful things that could invade our body are whole body pathogens, like an infectious microbe, like an infectious bacterium, okay? Others are simply parts of bad guys, or even irritants. And it all boils down to antigens, which are really the name tags that foreigners wear. Our own cells wear name tags as well, which are called antigens, but they're not going to elicit an immune response in our own body, at least hopefully. Okay, the immune system is also responsible for regulating cancerous growth, okay, and cleaning up continuously thanks to macrophages. Let's move on to the next slide, which is what, 16? Respiratory system is another focus of 242. Obviously, the main organs are gonna be the lungs. The trachea, you might know it as the windpipe. The sort of foyer, if you will, to the trachea is the larynx, and it houses the vocal folds. The nasal cavity and oral cavity also serve functions for the respiratory system. The chief muscles that regulate ventilation are the diaphragm and some of the muscles in between our ribs, but we'll come back to that. Ventilation is the movement of air into and out of the body, whereas respiration refers to gas exchange. Surrendering O2 from alveoli into the bloodstream, picking up CO2 from the bloodstream, and allowing it to leave the body, okay? Surprisingly, or at least I think it's somewhat sort of, I don't know. What's a good word for that? Not counterintuitive, but well, it's just non-intuitive. The respiratory system as well as the urinary system both have huge roles to play where pH balance, blood pH are concerned or is concerned. Thermoregulation is a big function of the respiratory system. When we take air into the body, we expose that air to so much surface area and so much vascularity that we actually end up warming it so that by the time it gets to our lungs, deep in our lungs, it more or less matches the temperature there. And when we exhale, when we move that same air out of the body, we reclaim a lot of that heat. So thermoregulation, you might think of it as insulation, although thermoregulation can have a lot to do with cooling off as well. And then because of those vocal folds that we just mentioned, speech or voice production is another function of the respiratory system. The digestive system has four main functions: ingestion, digestion, we talked about that being simply the breakdown of macromolecules. Absorption, we talked about that being sort of the transfer of nutrient monomers to the bloodstream. Hold on, I gotta make this legible, evidently. All right, and then we talked about among our necessary life functions, excretion, so certainly elimination of whatever we couldn't digest, as well as elimination of some potentially toxic byproducts, aka cellular waste. Okay. That's covered, but you will go into far more detail in 242 on the digestive system. The urinary system is another system that's focused on in 242. So hopefully you're starting to pick up on this trend that the number of organ systems that are gosh, I have no words today. Maybe I should be a teacher for a living. the number of systems that we emphasize in 241 is fairly low. There's just four: integumentary, skeletal, muscular, and nervous. And everything else gets thrown into 242, which, yeah, makes 242 really beefy and also a little bit disjunct, because it seems like we're moving from one organ system to something that's very different from one chapter to the next. But the reason why we have a smaller fraction of the organ systems in 241 and a larger fraction in 242 is because the nervous system is such a beast. In terms of macro anatomy, so sort of like the larger structures, the organs that are actually featured in the urinary system, oh my God, so easy. Two kidneys, two ureters, one urinary bladder, and one urethra. And really, the work of the urinary system is done by the kidneys. And we already previewed the functional units of kidneys, nephrons, earlier in this lecture. We already know that nephrons are filtering lots of things, and in fact, more than we actually eliminate as in urine, from the blood, including nitrogenous wastes, primarily urea at that point, and that we can alter how much water we lose as urine. Therefore, the urinary system regulates our water content, our ion content. And by the way, electrolyte is just sort of like the, commercial term for ion. An electrolyte and an ion are the same thing. And then again, I mentioned this just briefly in the respiratory system, pH, the pH of blood is regulated by both respiratory system and urinary system. Hold on, I gotta make it pretty. Can I make it pretty? That is debatable. There we go. The next two slides address the reproductive system, male reproductive system, female reproductive system. Both feature gonads. Gonads, specifically two gonads per body. Gonads are gamete-producing organs. And a gamete is also known as a sex cell. An example of a gamete would be sperm. And ova, which is plural. Singular is ovum. And we'll come back to this in 242. In the meantime, I'll just frustrate you. You've probably heard before that females are born with all of the ova they'll ever have. That is actually incorrect, or at least incomplete. We're born with all of the oocytes we're ever going to have. They don't actually become ova until the moment of fertilization. But we'll come back to that in 242, so no worries about that right now. The next slide, so 21. It's really just a placeholder to remind me that I want to talk about how organ systems interact with each other, or that they have to interact with each other. And you know what? We already talked about that. We already talked about our urea example. We already talked about our vitamin D synthesis example. So this slide is not necessary. We already covered it. All right. Next slide, number 22. Is introducing, well, actually, hopefully not introducing. Hopefully this is very old news from 160 and even other biology classes that you've had. Homeostasis. Homeostasis is the balance between ever-changing external environment and ever-adjusting internal environment. In other words, because the environment outside of our bodies is constantly changing, we have to constantly adjust inside. And in fact, the environment changes so fast and in so many different ways that in many senses, homeostasis is not something we can actually achieve. It's something we strive for, okay? And whenever we are out of homeostatic balance, in other words, whenever we feature a homeostatic imbalance, that is something that we, as a body, need to adjust for. That's something that we need to correct. If we can't correct it, well, we typically call that disease. All right. So we'll notice in chapter after chapter after chapter that rather than referring to a homeostatic imbalance as, say, a disease or an infection or a condition, the authors have simply chosen the phrase homeostatic imbalance. And that way we can include under that umbrella really anything that compromises our ability to actually achieve homeostasis, okay? Let's see, is there anything else on this slide that I wanted to point out? We already talked about sensory receptors, that command center, effectors. And in fact, if we go to the next slide, which is 23, hey, that's a familiar word. That's a familiar word. Sometimes people really cling to this mnemonic. Maybe you like that. We already talked about this, so we're done with that slide. We worked on it in advance. And in fact, if you go to the next slide, 24, hey, we talked about it. Okay? The only news on this slide is that sometimes when we make adjustments to the internal environment, cued by changes in the external environment, or sometimes even cued by changes, other changes in the internal environment, we employ homeostatic controls that are referred to as negative feedback and positive feedback. Negative feedback is far more common in the human body than positive feedback. So we can come up with lots of examples of negative feedback, but we'll only talk, at least at this point, about a couple of examples of positive feedback, okay? Personally, I find the easiest way to wrap my head around negative and positive feedback is to think about parenting. If our kid is throwing a fit at Target, you've heard this child, I know you have, and we employ negative feedback as our control mechanism, then we're gonna punish the child. Whereas if we employ positive feedback as our control mechanism, then we're gonna wait for the child to behave well and then praise the child. In the next slide, you'll notice there's sort of like a teeter-totter or a I guess, balance beam. What do people call that now? I don't know. It's a plank on a fulcrum. Okay. Seesaw, thank you. It's really just, again, reiterating sensor receptor, command center, effectors, right? And the fact that if we are experiencing homeostatic imbalance, at least a healthy body, a normal body, will adjust to try, at least, to bring us back into a homeostatic norm or a homeostatic range of norm. Next slide. Negative feedback, again, is very, very common. All right. And the gist is that negative feedback operates to sort of turn off, shut down, or turn down, reduce a response. Okay? We talked about applying that to parenting, okay? But we can also apply that to the thermostat in your house. We can apply that to the thermostat in your body. And your chief thermostat, or the part of your body that acts similarly to an actual thermostat in your house is the hypothalamus. And soon we'll find out the hypothalamus has a gazillion different functions. But one of its functions is to sort of monitor and therefore prompt adjustments to body temperature, okay? And if we look at the following slide, you'll notice that I sort of blanked out part of it. That's because I just want to focus on, dang, we're hot, we need to cool off. Dang, we're hot, we need to cool off. If the stimulus is heat and the response is to promote sweat gland activity, then once that sweat evaporates from our skin, taking not just the water molecule, but also heat off the skin with it, then we stop sweating, right? Shut it down, turn it off, reduce it, okay? If we look at the next slide, again, using thermoregulation as a model, oh, dang, we're so cold. The stimulus now is cold, extreme cold, right? What does the body do to respond? Well, lots of things, but one of those sort of guaranteed responses in a normal body is shivering, right? That sort of rapid involuntary contraction of our skeletal muscles, right? Once shivering warms us up enough, we're gonna turn off shivering. It's not like once I turn on shivering, I'm gonna shiver for the rest of my life, right? Or once I turn on my sweat glands, I'm gonna sweat for the rest of my life, right? These things turn off. Once we are back at our homeostatic norm, we stop the response, okay? Now I'm back at slide 26. We just talked about body temperature. Often the contents of blood, so blood glucose, blood calcium, for instance, also are regulated via a negative feedback mechanism. So once, for instance, blood glucose is high enough, we're going to stop telling the body to make glucose available, or vice versa. If glucose is lower than homeostatic norm, we're going to bring glucose levels back up to homeostatic norm and stop. We don't want to exceed homeostatic norm. We don't want to overshoot our mark, okay? Same thing with blood calcium. Blood pressure also operates, or blood pressure regulation also operates via a negative feedback mechanism, okay? Let's look then at slide 29, positive feedback. So if negative feedback ultimately turns off or at least reduces a response, positive feedback amplifies, promotes, continues to stimulate a response. And probably the go-to, oh, this looks like it, that's odd. There's something missing here. We can fix it. Often the go-to that people may have heard of has to do with delivering a baby. When the cervix becomes soft and irritated and stretched by an ever-growing fetus, we produce more oxytocin, and oxytocin in turn further softens and irritates and thins the cervix, which then tells us, hey, we better release more oxytocin, which then further softens and thins and irritates the cervix. So it's kind of snowballing, right? And that snowball effect, or that even that snowball imagery, is absolutely positive feedback. It's a positive feedback mechanism. Now, does that mean positive feedback never ends? well, let's think about that. If we're gonna use delivery of a child as one of our models, our go-to examples, I don't know, or once you're in delivery, are you delivering a baby for the rest of your life? Would we ever have babies if that were the case? I don't think that, no. So obviously the mechanism does eventually shut off, but the point of positive feedback is to amplify, ramp it up, ramp it up, ramp it up, let it snowball until we finally achieve this very maximal response, okay? Some other go-tos, pepsinogen, it's really something we're gonna come back to in 242. It's a product of the stomach, and it's released when, for instance, protein molecules are plentiful in the stomach, because when pepsinogen is activated, it becomes an enzyme that breaks down proteins. So the more pepsinogen is produced, the more of it will be converted into that enzyme that's called pepsin. The more pepsin can break down those proteins, and the more those protein particles can say, hey, why don't you release some pepsinogen? So another feedback mechanism or snowball sort of effect. Here's a nice one that's not, it doesn't have anything to do with the human body, at least not directly. If you think of water vapor in our immediate atmosphere, water vapor, along with CO2 and methane, is one of the three chief greenhouse gases. And the more water vapor there is in the atmosphere, the more it will trap heat. But the hotter the atmosphere, or the more heat that's trapped against the surface of the earth, the more liquid water will evaporate, and for that matter, the more solid water will liquefy. So in that sense, you could say water vapor begets water vapor begets water vapor begets water vapor. So kind of a nice sort of ecological example, okay? We already talked about a parenting example. Blood clotting also works via a positive feedback mechanism. I want that clot to get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. I want it to snowball until finally I have blocked any possibility of blood loss, okay? We'll come back to blood clotting in 242 as well. Next slide. Again, our authors are going to use the phrase homeostatic imbalance. Okay, very, very often. It's really any issue with homeostasis, whether it's a disease or a compromise that we all feature, okay? But certainly when we are experiencing homeostatic imbalance, we're at greater risk of disease, we're at greater risk of aging, okay? And I think I built in another slide just in case, but I don't think I need it. I think we're good.